Welcome to this episode of the Gunman. In this video, I'll be taking you guys through how to do a spot repair, and I'll be demonstrating on this 1974 Mark II Jensen Healey. It's got a soft top on it too. So we're going to be doing a spot repair, and the name of the colour is just called yellow. So 882 was the paint code. That was the best I could come up with anyway. From the research I did, I'm pretty sure the colour code was just called yellow. So I'm starting off here with some 180 grit, using the palm sander, Dynabrade palm sander, and just sanding into those scratches that someone had touched up. You can see they tried touching it up, but the colour wasn't quite right, and it just sort of was a bit of an eyesore. So the owner decided to bring it into us and get it just spot repaired. It turned out there was actually a bit of a low spot there and a bit of a dent underneath those touch-ups, so I decided just to put a bit of 2-pack fine filler into it. I'm using the Worth brand here. I've found it's probably one of the best fillers that you've got even on the market. It's lightweight, it's over-paintable, it doesn't generally get left with any pinholes. If you're doing a larger area, sometimes you will get a pinhole or two. But it's a very good quality filler, this one. You pay for it, but it's good quality. It's $50 for one of them kits there. So just spending a little bit of extra time on getting this filler in, feathering, making sure those edges aren't too big and thick. Look, I'm just a spray painter, and to be honest, I've done a fair bit of restoration work and panel work as well, but I've seen panel beaters who still can't even do this stuff. It's their daily job, and some of them are just absolutely atrocious, and they just make such a big mess out of some of these cars. That's why a lot of the time with these jobs, the boss just comes straight down to me. He says, you do the job, you know what you're doing. It'll be quicker and easier if you just do it yourself. So once I put that in, I gave it about 15 minutes. Unfortunately, I did think I was recording. I must have not pressed the button on the camcorder quite hard enough, and it didn't record. So I thought I was going to include the footage of me sanding that filler out, but not to worry, on to the next step. But all I did to sand that filler out was just 180 grit on the orbital sander first. Once I took that top layer off, I blocked it down with a sanding block and then feathered it all out with some 320 grit, Scotch-brighted the edges, masked it up with some paper, then over with the plastic, tucked the plastic underneath, and then just put my 2-pack primer on is what I'm using here. So just mixed it up 4-to-1, which is the mixing ratio for that primer. It's a Standox product, this one. One of the best quality primers I've used, and just putting 3 coats on there, and then I left it overnight. I came in the next morning and I'm starting on the paintwork, and so I'm just using the mini buff there. I decided to put some tape over that moulding so I don't burn it. You can sometimes hit that with the buff, and the heat generated from the buff can burn those mouldings and stuff like that. So just putting a bit of tape over it and just polishing where my clear blend is going to be. So just using the juice Q-cut here. It's a nice fine, sort of halfway in between a cutter and a polish, so it's a nice fine one, and it's still going to bring it up quite nicely. I'm going to be painting this car in clear over base. So the reason I'm starting off by polishing it as well is so that I can actually take my color reading. So I'm going to go up, mix up my colour first, and then I'll be able to have that colour drying while I'm doing my prep work, so I don't have any downtime. That's another good thing to think about when you're working in a workshop environment, is that because the colour takes time to dry, if you go get all your prep work done and then you go and do try to mix your colour up, then you're just going to be waiting for the paint to dry. So yeah, good use of your time is to do your colour first on these solid colours so that it can dry. And I've got one of the cards drying now. I've then came back, got some 320 grit on the orbital sander there with the interface pad, or the soft foam pad in between the hard pad of the Dynabrade there, and just 320 grit. So I decided this, it really didn't need blocking. It was actually quite straight after I blocked it the day before, so there's no need to re-block it, I decided this time. Sometimes if it was a black and it was sort of right in the middle of a a big flat panel, yeah, I might decide to block it, but it just didn't warrant it on this job. So I'll just give you guys a quick look at the color here and take you through how I do a bit of the color matching. So it started off, the one on the right there, it was just a bit too vibrant and a bit too sort of yellow. And so to help kill that down a bit, I used a bit of black and white, and that's the one on the left there. And it did start to sort of just tone it down a bit, get rid of that yellowness, the vibrant yellow. And then after that, it's still a little bit bright, so I decided to put just a touch more white and black in it, just to grey it out a bit more, and just a bit of the lemon yellow, which you'll see me adding in here. So just whacking those gloves back on there, as not to get too much paint on my hands. And 575 is the yellow I'm going to put in, and just a touch of the white there as well. And I'll just be doing another color card as well, just to double check that I'm happy with it before I do paint it. So I just dip one of these little color cards in, put it up in, we've got a little heat light over in the corner, and then we just dry it out. And because I'm doing it in clear over base, it's very important that you do put clear over it as well, being that it's a solid color. If I was to do it in metallic, you'd have to spray it on there. You wouldn't be able to dunk it in like you see me doing, but this is a solid color, so it's got no metallic in there, so I'm able to just dunk it in, and it does need clear coat, whereas in metallics, you can usually just get away with spraying a bit of wax and grease remover over it, and that's going to give you the shine and emulate the clear coat. But with the solid color, the clear coat actually does change the color. So while that's drying, again, I've came back to the car, and I'm going to start sanding these edges here. I'm using 500 grit now. I usually like to put colour, where I'm going to put my colour, I'll use 500 grit. Where I'm going to be putting my clear, I'll use 800 grit. And where I'm going to be doing my clear blend, I'll use grey coloured Scotch-Brite. So the Scotch-Brite pads are colour coded, so don't just think, oh, I can use any Scotch-Brite. They're all the same, because they're not. They are actually color coded. So the red and the greens are the coarsest ones. The gray is the light one, and then there's another step up, another even finer one, which is white, which I honestly never use. We've got some there. Some of the other guys like to use it, but I found it just doesn't even scratch into it enough to even sort of be sure that the paint's going to bite into it. So you got to make sure that when you're sanding panels down, that there's no shiny spots left. Any shiny spots, and the fresh paint's not going to stick to it. So just using 800 grit there, because that's where I'm just going to be putting my clear coat. And as I mentioned earlier, just that bit of grey Scotch-Brite to go over the blend surface. You can see it's dulling it down nice and nicely. And you'll see me do the blend over this surface later on with my blending thinner. So once that's done, we'll give it a good blow off with the airline. I then decided to wipe it down with some wax and grease remover. This car is actually painted in acrylic lacquer, so it's prone to a few issues when you're putting solvent-based 2-pack over the top of it. One of them being fry-ups. So we actually end up having a fry-up, so I'll show you guys how to fix that if you hang around for a couple more minutes. And we also have another paint problem come up. See where that bit of filler is below that headlight to the left there? I put that filler in, and the owner of this car obviously really loves it. I actually have started falling in love with the car myself. It's a beautiful car as you have a look around it. But what they like to do is use waxes and polishes to keep the paint looking nice, especially on these acrylic cars. They need polishing quite regularly. And in doing that, that puts the wax inside all those little cracks and nooks and crannies and stuff where I'm actually trying to fill up. And that wax leads to some silicon and wax hole problems later on, which you'll see. So this is the final look at that colour. You can see there that it's really come along quite nicely. So with two changes, because we had the original and then two changes, we're able to come up with a really nice match there. To get that color, I use the Standox spectrophotometer, which is a machine that takes three photos of the paintwork, and then you plug that up to your computer. It will scan the database and it'll actually scan every single color, and it will say, well, I think this color is better than the actual Jensen color, which is some of the paint companies, you've just got to use colored cards and stuff like that. But the Standox has got a quite good system with the spectrophotometer. It saves a bit of time there sometimes as well, running around looking for paint codes and stuff like that. And also in color matching, because it does shade the color as well, so it'll not just find the color, it will also, with that photo you've taken, it'll say, well, it might leave a little bit of the black out, and it might add a bit of the white if it thinks it's a little bit too dark or something like that. So we've obviously gone around, done all the edge masking just there. Next up, I'm putting a piece of plastic over the entire car, and I'm then just going to be getting a nice sharp razor blade and cutting around my edge masking. So you saw me when I was doing my primer work, I put paper over it, and then when I'm in here doing the paint work, I like to go straight over with the plastic. I just find it saves time in the booth here, and we usually don't reuse the plastic, the sheets of plastic, when we're in the spray booth, but when we're out in the workshop, just to save a couple of dollars, we like to reuse the plastic on the next car a couple of times. So yeah, just going around all those edges, using nice big pieces of tape there. The sort of, if you have them nice and big, then there's less edges and gaps and stuff like that, where there's a possibility of any of your paint getting through and creating overspray on the next panel or anything like that. So obviously just being careful that you don't cut straight through that plastic into the surrounding paintwork, obviously. Don't laugh, I've seen people do it. So anyway, just continuing on with that masking, and next up we're going to be wiping it down with some wax and grease remover, and taking you through as you see on the headlights around there, there's the black on the inside of the headlight. We're not going to be fixing that black. It was just a bit of a tidy up for the owner. He wanted to keep the cost down, and where we just decided this was the best way to do it. My boss wanted me to do it this way, so I did it. And so give it a good wipe down with the wax and grease remover. Next up, I'm going to be using the vinyl tape. So it's the blue fine line tape, we call it. I found it actually sticks a little bit better, because as I mentioned before, the guys obviously waxed this car a fair bit. I actually struggled to get that normal masking tape just to even stick to some of those places, so this fine line tape I've found actually sticks quite a lot better. But with that fine line tape, just try not to leave it in your spray booth and bake it. I've found it can end up just sort of melting and bending and stuff like that. So you can see this roll has actually sort of been baked before. Some of the other guys just always seem to leave it in the booth, and there's not much you can do about it. And yeah, just try and keep the edges clean. I usually like to just leave it out on the masking machine outside on the paper machine. So it's going around that edge, and that's sticking really nicely. That's not peeling back like I had with the normal masking tape there. So just going around that edge. And next up, we'll just be grabbing our tack cloth, wiping the entire thing down with the tack cloth, and we'll start putting our colour on. So you'll be able to see here straight away, as soon as I get that colour on. Look, if I had put it on a touch lighter, well then maybe it wouldn't have fried up, but maybe it still would have, just because of that acrylic paint that's under there. It's on the edge of where my primer went on. Had I primed the whole thing and sealed it down, yep, maybe I would have been able to avoid that fry up issue. So I'll get up nice and close for you so you can have a bit of a look at it. And you can really see that really didn't take long at all, and that's just frying straight up. So as soon as I saw that, I just thought, well, there's not much I can do now. It's there. I went off, had my Spunko break, forgot about it for about 10 minutes. The booth set to about 30 degrees, which is about 76 degrees Fahrenheit. And then I came back 15 minutes later, I was able to sand it out. So you can see there where I put that filler under the headlight panel, and that's what I was talking about, where it's silicon effect, or the wax holes, or fish eyes you may call them. And the best way to fix that is just to dust your base coat, and you can see there, just with one dust, it's already improving it. So that's been about 10 minutes in between leaving it. You can see it's actually settled down a little bit because the solvents have started to evaporate out of that base coat of mine. This is a pretty common problem with acrylic paints and stuff like that. They've sort of haven't really been used, well, not in Australia, since the 90s anyway. So early 90s, I'm pretty sure around then. Two-pack was pretty much in every major shop anyway. So I'm just using a bit of 500 grit there, one of those softback sanding sponges, just giving it a good sand out. I'll then be grabbing that tack cloth again, because it's created obviously a bit of dust around. Be tack ragging it back down, and just applying my base coat on it just a touch lighter this time, as to make sure we don't have that reaction. So basically what's happening there is, yeah, my solvents are just attacking into that acrylic, which basically two-pack, if you leave two-pack for 30 days, that's going to be fully cured. You can get a thinner's rag, gum wash or thinner's rag, and that's just going to freshen it. It will not freshen it back up with two-pack, but with the acrylic, you can leave that for years, and if you get a bit of thinners, you'll be able to actually freshen that paint back up. So it's not two-pack, it doesn't have a hardener with those acrylic paints. So no one really uses it anymore, thank God. There's still a few cars out there that have got it on there. Some people that do their restorations have their mindset on using acrylic. Oh, because the car's been painted in acrylic, I want it painted in acrylic. There's no benefit from acrylic, to be honest. Really no benefit. About the only real benefit is that it's easier to polish up, because it doesn't go fully hard. It sort of stays a bit soft, so buffing it up will be a lot easier. But that's about the one thing I can think of. So yeah, just letting it dry nice in between coats, and just sort of dusting that base coat on. That's the best way to avoid that frying up and those wax holes and fish eyes from coming back. Just waiting in between coats, dusting it on, and yeah, I'm pretty happy with what we've got here. To be honest, I probably actually expected it to come back up a bit, but it didn't. These kind of colours, the solid colours, are also a little bit more forgiving too. If you were to have like a sanding scratch or something like that, if there was one or two sanding scratches I saw in the base coat, you'd probably be able to actually fill it up with the clear coat. So onto our clear coat now. As I said, we're just using the 2-pack clear. Duke's own 2K clear is what I'm using. The GTI Pro Lite with the T2 air cap on it. Awesome gun, very easy to use. So I gave that 5 minutes in between coats, walked out of the booth 5 minutes, come back in, and we're putting our second coat back on now. And just sort of with that clear coat, I'm going up sort of halfway through those Scotch-Brite marks that I used before, that you see me using before. And then with that minigun that you see sitting there on the windscreen, I'm going to go over, swap over to that minigun. It's got a 1.2mm fluid needle and tip on it, and it's got a very small fan on it, but it's very good just for the blending thinner here. Just careful you don't go on too wet with it, but that's a good thing about having such a mini gun, the small gun. It's not going to overload the paint. If you are to put this into your colour gun or to your paint gun, then just be careful, because I have a bit embarrassed actually at trade school. You go into trade school, I put it into my colour gun and had a big run. That was when I was an apprentice. So as you can see here, that's looking quite nice off the gun. One or two little bits of dust in it, and we'll be taking it around the back and polishing it up. That will be included in the next video, the polishing stage. So, just decided to give you a listen to this. I think they've got a Lotus engine in these things. Bit of a beast. I really like this car. It really did start to grow on me. And here we go with another look at it. As it sits here, it hasn't been washed up yet. but I'll still give you a bit of a look at it at the interior. I'll tell you one thing, if you're very tall, you wouldn't really want to get one of these unless you lived in a really nice environment that didn't rain much, because you'd be able to put that top down. But for me, I was hitting my head on that roof, so I had to duck down a little bit, and I'm only 6 foot. So if you're much bigger than that, you'd want to make sure you drive around with the top down. But beautiful looking car, dries really nicely. Hang around here, check out a couple of my other links. I've got a really nice old Mercedes that I did a similar job on. I've also got a brand new Volvo V40. Check out my channel there too. Make sure you subscribe as well. Thanks again for watching, and this has been another Gunman production. Goodbye.